So now let us discuss about heat pump. A heat pump is a thermodynamic system operating in a thermodynamic cycle that removes heat from a low temperature body and delivers heat to a high temperature body. To accomplish this energy transfer, the heat pump receives external energy in the form of work or heat from the surroundings. While the name heat pump is a thermodynamic term used to describe a cyclic device that allows the heat transfer from a low temperature to a high temperature, we use the terms refrigerator and heat pump to apply to a particular devices. Here, a refrigerator is a device that operates on thermodynamic cycle and extracts heat from a low temperature medium, and the heat pump also operates on a thermodynamic cycles but rejects heat to the high temperature medium. So that is the basic difference between refrigerator and heat pump. The refrigerator takes the heat from a low temperature medium and heat pump delivers or rejects the heat to a high temperature medium. Both operate in a similar cycle. So let us take this example. So in this heat pump system is shown in the heating mode. So this is the heat pump operation in the heating mode. In the heating mode, high pressure vapor refrigerant is sent to the indoor heat exchanger coil. So we are getting from the compressor, we are getting a high pressure vapor refrigerant which is going through this reversing valve to the indoor coil, where it rejects its energy or its heat to the inside air and condenses in the form of liquid. Then this liquid goes to the expansion valve and then it is throttled to a low pressure. Then it goes to the outdoor coil and receives energy from the outside air. Now this again vaporizes and then it goes to the compressor again, so that the compressor can compress it to the high pressure vapor again. So this is how the heat pump operates. It takes the heat from the outdoor coil and rejects to the inside. Now if you reverse this direction, that will be the cooling mode working. So in case of cooling mode, the compressed vapor will go through this reversing valve to the outdoor coil. It will reject its heat here, convert it into the liquid, then it will come to the expansion valve, then the pressure will be reduced, then it will receive heat from the indoor coil, again converted into the vapor, and then it will go to the compressor. So this is the basic difference between the heating and cooling mode of the heat pump operation. Now this is the typical example of the refrigerator that we use in our home. In this is our refrigerated space. From that refrigerated space, this evaporator is taking some heat into it, QL. Then it is going to the compressor where it is compressed. The refrigerant is going to the compressor where it is compressed to high pressure, high temperature. Then this high pressure, high temperature vapor will go to the condenser, which is normally on the backside of the refrigerator, where it rejects the heat to the kitchen air surrounding medium. So it rejects heat in the condenser, again comes back at the 800 kilopascal and 30 degrees Celsius. So basically the temperature is reduced here, and then from the expansion valve or throttling device, the pressure is further reduced, and then again it goes to the evaporator to receive some amount of heat. So this is how the domestic refrigerator works. So basically it is taking heat from a low temperature refrigerated space and it is rejecting the heat to a high temperature with the help of some net input in the compressor. So to determine the coefficient of performance or index of performance for a refrigerator or heat pump, it is the ratio of desired result to the input. So COP, coefficient of performance, is the ratio of desired result to the required input. This measure of performance may be larger than 1 and we want the COP to be as large as possible. So now the heat, let's say the heat pump is acting like a refrigerator or an air conditioner. The primary function is to transfer the heat from the low temperature system. So this is our desired output if it is working as a refrigerator or air conditioner. So our desired output is how much heat can be extracted from this place, and the required input is how much net work input is required in the compressor. So we can define the COP of the refrigerator, COP of refrigerator, as the desired output, which is QL, divided by required input, which is W net in. So QL is the heat extracted from the low temperature divided by the net work input. So now we can apply the first law to this cyclic refrigerator. First law is Q net minus W net is equal to delta U cycle, which is 0. So delta U cycle is 0, Q net is QL minus QH minus W out is 0 minus W in. So W in or W net in will be equal to QH minus QL. So the coefficient of performance becomes COP of the refrigerator. Now can be written as QL divided by QH minus QL. We have replaced the W in with QH minus QL. Now if the device is acting like a heat pump, the primary function of the device is to transfer the heat to the higher temperature system. The coefficient of performance for a heat pump is coefficient of performance for HP, which stands for heat pump. That is, the desired output is QH in this case divided by W net required input, or QH divided by QH minus QL. Now from this equation, COP of refrigerator, you can see that if we add 1 to this COP of refrigerator, we will get the COP of heat pump. So we can relate the COP of heat pump and COP of refrigerator as COP of heat pump will be equal to COP of refrigerator plus 1 under the same operating conditions. Now, so there are certain statements of second law. So the following two statements of the second law of thermodynamics are based on the definitions of heat engine and heat pumps. So the first statement of second law of thermodynamics is Kelvin-Planck statement of the second law. The Kelvin-Planck statement is, it is impossible for any device that operates on a cycle to receive heat from a single reservoir and produce a net amount of work. So this is the Kelvin-Planck statement of the second law of thermodynamics, that it is impossible to construct a device which is taking heat from a single reservoir and converting it to work, net amount of work. So this kind of device is not possible. So in other words, it states that no heat engine can produce a net amount of work while exchanging heat with a single reservoir only. So it is not possible for a heat engine to produce 100% net work output, or that is 100% efficiency. So there has to be some heat rejection to the lower temperature or lower temperature reservoir. So this is the Kelvin-Planck statement of the second law, that you cannot make a device such that which takes the heat from single reservoir, or in this case that is 100 kilowatt, and converts all 100 kilowatt into work, and QL is 0. So this kind of device is not possible as per the Kelvin-Planck statement of second law, and the efficiency has to be less than 100%. Then comes the Clausius statement of second law. It states that it is impossible to construct a device that operates in a cycle and produce no effect other than the transfer of heat from low temperature body to a high temperature body. So again, this kind of arrangement, that it is taking heat from low temperature, that is 5 kilojoule, it takes the heat from low temperature space and delivers that 5 kilojoule to the high temperature body without any work input. So this kind of arrangement is not possible as per the Clausius statement of second law, that we cannot construct a device that operates in a cycle and produces no effect other than the transfer of heat from a low temperature body to a high temperature body. So this kind of arrangement is also not possible. So we have to take some amount of energy in the form of work, and then only we can transfer the heat from low temperature to the high temperature. So the COP of a refrigerator or heat pump must be less than infinity. So COP will be less than infinity, it can be more than 1, but it will be less than infinity. Now we can relate these two statements of second law, that is Kelvin-Planck and Clausius statement of second law, and the violation of one will leads to the violation of other. So let us assume that we have an engine, heat engine, which has 100% efficiency. That is, it is violating the Kelvin-Planck statement. It is taking heat QH from the high temperature reservoir, and it is converting all the QH into W net, that is into work. So we have a heat engine which is violating the Kelvin-Planck statement. Now we have coupled this heat engine with a refrigerator which is taking heat from low temperature device and delivering that heat to the high temperature device with the help of W net from the heat engine. Now if we join these two devices, so what is happening is we are taking QL from the low temperature and we are delivering QL to the high temperature, that is QH is cancelled out, so QL is taken from low temperature and QL is delivered to the high temperature, which is again the violation of Clausius statement. So we cannot make a device if it is violating the Kelvin-Planck statement, it will lead to violation of Clausius statement also. So both these statements are related to each other. Now we will see some definition. Perpetual motion machines, if any device that violates the first or second law of thermodynamics is called a perpetual motion machine. If the device violates the first law, it is known as perpetual motion machine of first kind, PMM1, and if the device violates the second law, it is a perpetual motion machine of the second kind, PMM2. Another definition is reversible process. A reversible process is a quasi-equilibrium and quasi-static process with a more restrictive requirement. There are two types of reversible processes. Internally reversible, if the process internally reversible, then it is once having take place can be reversed and in doing so leave no change in the system. It does not say anything about the surrounding of the system. In case of externally reversible process, it is also a quasi-equilibrium process and once having taken place, it can be reversed and in doing so leave no change in the system or surroundings. So in externally reversible process, it can be reversed and it will not leave any change in the system and surrounding both, and internally reversible process, it will not leave any change in the system itself. Then comes the irreversible process. An irreversible process is a process that is not reversible. So all real processes are reversible because of the following: friction, unrestrained expansion of gases, heat transfer through a finite temperature difference, mixing of two different substances, I squared R losses in electrical circuits, and any deviation from a quasi-static process. Quasi-static means almost static process, very slow process.